Hello everyone. So today we are going to start chapter 1 of class 9 economics. The name of the chapter is The Story of Village Palampur. What are we to study in this chapter? What is the objective of this chapter? The objective for this chapter is to introduce some basic concepts relating to production. And we shall come to know about this after reading about this particular village, which is a hypothetical village. Hypothetical, it means not existing in reality. Farming is the main occupation or the activity of Palampur. If I talk about the facilities of the village Palampur, then village Palampur has various facilities. Whatever is required recently by each and every one for their livelihood, each and everything is found to be there in the village Palampur. For example, electricity supply is there. We shall find two primary schools and one high school to be there. Primary health center is there, which is being run by the government. And one private dispensary is also there, where the sick people can be treated. Rather than this, if I talk about communication facilities, then it is well connected to a big village, that is Raiganj. And just near to Raiganj, there is Shahpur, which is a town. So connectivity is there by metallic roads, which makes the transportation easy. So if I say that tube wells are there, electric tube wells are there, by which the irrigation supply is there. So such kind of village is said to be a village, just like the one which is found to be in the western UP. Now let me talk about the division of society in the village Palampur. The overall families which are found to be living in this village are about 450 families. They belong to different castes. Out of 450, 80 families, they belong to upper caste families. They have their own land. The majority of the land in the village belongs to 80 upper caste families. Their houses are there. Their houses are quite large. Pakka houses they are. If I talk about SC, ST and OBC, that is Dalits, then one third of the total population, that is 150, because one third of 450 is 150. They are found to be living in small houses. Some of the houses are kacha houses made of mud and straw. But most of the houses have electric connection. As well as we find electric tube wells to be there in the fields, which is being used in various types of small business. So overall, we find roads, transport, electricity, irrigation, school and health center to be there, which tells us that it is a well-developed village. Now let me come to that first point of the chapter, that is organization of production. If I say about organization of production, that is to produce the goods and services, that is the main aim of the organization of production. If we just want to produce anything or goods to be there in existence, then ultimately services are there because we need labor. There are four requirements for production of goods and services. Without these four requirements, the production is impossible. If any one of the factors is found to be missing, then also the production is impossible. The very first factor is land. The second factor is labor. The third factor is physical capital. Physical capital, we can divide it into two parts. Number one, fixed capital, and the second, working capital, and the last is human capital. Now let me discuss about land. The first requirement is land. together with other natural resources such as water, minerals, etc. Without land, the production is impossible. Whether you are going to set up machinery or going to build up a factory or any other thing, for the production to be there to produce goods, then the very first thing is land. To work on the land, we need labor. So labor is the second requirement for the organization of the production, because without labor, the goods cannot be produced. Now, as I said to you, that physical capital can be divided into two, fixed and working. So what is fixed? For example, you have built an infrastructure, or you have purchased a tractor to use it in your fields, or you have purchased all the equipments which are necessary for plowing. So these come under fixed capital because you are going to use them continuously. So tools and machine ranges from very simple tool, for example plow, to generators, turbines, computers, etc. We are going to use them for a number of years, one after the other to come. And as a result, they are said to be asset or fixed capital. Now, rather than fixed capital or assets, we require certain loose money that is said to be the working capital. For example, if you are to pay money to the labor, then ultimately you need money in hand, that is working capital. You are to purchase the raw material, then also you need loose money, that is working capital. So the fourth requirement, that is human capital. Without it, everything is impossible, because it is knowledge. Human capital means knowledge, your ideas, your skills, which you are going to use and collaborate all the three factors, land, labor and physical capital, so that the production is there, the goods are being produced together with the services. Land is fixed. What does it mean? Yes. If I ask you a question that can you stretch a land? Is it just stretchable like a rubber band? No. Nobody can stretch it just like a rubber band. So land is fixed. Now the land is fixed, but as the years are rolling, we find the population to be increasing. One year is given in the book, that is the year 1960, when the Palampur was found to be having the land for agriculture. The same pieces of land are found to be there. No more land has increased because land is fixed. Some of the wastelands were there. Those lands have also been converted into agriculture land. Now no more land is there. So as a result, we find the land to be less as in comparison to the population, which has been increasing from 1960 onwards. So how are we going to cope up with land being fixed? How are we going to fulfill the needs of the people who are found to be increasing with time, or the population which is found to be increasing with time? So one way, that is various ways to grow more from the same land. Using the same piece of land, you can grow more crops. Now what are that ways? The very first way, for example, if you have 2 acres of land, you can divide into 2 or 3. For example, on 1 acre you are growing wheat, and on 0.5 and 0.5 you have grown sugarcane, as well as you have put a threshing machine, which is also going to give you a good earning. So that is also a way to increase your input or the total income. But multiple cropping system, what it is? Multiple cropping system, it means that to grow more than one crop on the same piece of land during the year, that is said to be multiple cropping. For example, if I have a 2 acre land, and during the rainy season, when I know that kharif crops are found to be grown, and I have sown jowar and bajra, so ultimately they are found to be growing for the very first crop. These plants, they can be used as a cattle fodder or the feed for the cattle we can get. It is followed by cultivation of potato between October and November. That is the second crop which I am to grow is potato. And I am going to cultivate it between October and December. In the winter season, when comes the season of rabi crops, I have sown wheat. That is the third crop. I know very well that I have used three different crops. So while using three different crops, one must be quite sure that these crops which you are going to produce or which you are going to sow, so that the production is there, they do not require the same minerals. Because the soil also needs certain time to replenish itself. Thing. Now all these can be sold in the market of Raiganj, which is 3 kilometers away from Palampur. Now one question comes, why farmers are able to grow three different crops in a year in Palampur? Just because of well-developed irrigation system and electricity which came very early to Palampur, the farmers of Palampur, they are able to grow three different crops. That is, multiple cropping system is found to be there. Thing. Now let us proceed. Natural seeds versus HYV seeds. Natural seeds, they are sown or are being used by the farmers. Still they are being used by the farmers. They do not require much irrigation. Very little water is there. The farmer can depend on the rainfall itself. You can use the manure instead of man-made fertilizers. If you compare to the production or the yield, what we say the total produce, we find the production to be very less in case of natural seeds than that of HYV seeds. Now as the name HYV seed suggests, its full name is high yielding variety seeds. Now such kind of seeds are being used by the farmers to increase the production. But if you are going to use HYV seeds, then ultimately you need latest techniques of irrigation. You need fertilizers, man-made fertilizers, pesticides, insecticides to be used. Then only you can find your production to be enhancing. Now one thing is there, that when you are using excessively man-made fertilizers, then waterlogging problem is found to be there, and if the waterlogging problem comes, then ultimately the plants, they get destroyed. And even the soil, it becomes more saline. Now there are positive and negative outcomes of Green Revolution. When Green Revolution came in the late 1960s, the Indian farmers were there to cultivate wheat and rice using HYV seeds as compared to traditional or natural seeds. As a result, the same piece of land would now produce far larger quantities of food grains than that was possible earlier. So if we look at the Green Revolution, we find the production to be increasing, the needs to be met easily by using HYV seeds together with chemical fertilizers, pesticides and insecticides. But this Green Revolution, it was not spread in the whole of the country. It was very common in Punjab, Haryana, Western UP and others. Why it was possible? Because the farmers in these regions, they have set up tube wells for irrigation, and these tube wells were being used together with HYV seeds for irrigation, and as a result the crop was there. So Green Revolution one way gives rise to good production, but at the same time you find a drawback to be there, that is excessive use of human fertilizers or man-made fertilizers. They decrease the quality of the soil. It may not be productive as it used to be. And if you want to make it more productive, you will have to add more and more man-made fertilizers. That is the drawback of the Green Revolution, though it has fulfilled the quantity, but the quality of the soil is reducing. Thank you.